a nonprofit whose mission is to increase restoration initiatives worldwide. And Restor's very own Clara Rowe, CEO, is here to tell us more. Clara, it's lovely to have you here.
It's wonderful to be here. Thanks for having me.
And also joining us for this discussion is J09, who is the environmental quantification lead at Bühler. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
So, Clara, we'll start with you. What is Restor doing and why is it important?
So Restor is a platform for democratizing access to data, ecological data, monitoring data, and we do that in order to be able to accelerate restoration and conservation work around the world. And we do it because restoration has this incredible potential for increasing planetary resilience. On the one hand, it can prevent up to 60% of species extinctions. It can draw down about 30% of carbon that is accumulated in the atmosphere since the Industrial Revolution, and it can improve livelihoods for over a billion people. So we really want to help unlock that potential by providing good data to people who can do something with it on the ground.
And in order, I suppose, Jay, for us to know whether any initiative is going to work, you have to measure it. So tell me what sort of methodology you've put into deciding how you do measure these things.
Absolutely. Clara referred to it earlier, that we have all these greenhouse gases that are being emitted since the Industrial Revolution, and this is what's causing drastic climate change, and we're seeing the adverse effects around us. And we need to measure what we're doing because we can't manage what we can't measure. And there is where we use CO2 equivalent, which equates all the greenhouse gases together into one equivalent metric. And this is quite powerful because it makes it comparable with different processes and different industries or different parts of the value chain. Bühler as a company, providing technology to feed close to 2 billion people per day and move 1 billion people per day. And it's important that we're able to measure the environmental impacts of the products processed for that technology, and also those individual sites and all parts of the value chain, so that we can make informed decisions about technology procurement, but also other areas, so that we can start to really limit and reduce the environmental impact that we have in food processing or any type of processing.
Yeah, but the question was, how do you do that? What's the methodology? Yes, I understand the importance of it, but how do you do it?
So we take a combination of primary and secondary data. So primary data being something as simple as a gas or electricity bill. And you take that data, it might be in kilowatt hours or something like that, could be any activity. And then you equate that into CO2 emissions using emission factors. And these are widely available for electricity, for taking the train to work, for anything you eat. And then you also have secondary data where you might not have access to primary data. You might say just one ton of wheat coming out the ground. That would be an assumption, secondary data, which is still quite powerful to combine because you can't have data everywhere. And then simply you add up the emissions of the activities all across the value chain or for a certain site, depending on what you're looking to do. And this is all laid out in the greenhouse gas protocol. There are different standards that then help you to do what's laid out in the greenhouse gas protocol as well. Okay. Did that answer the methodology?
Yes, thank you. Second attempt, but I appreciate it. Thank you.
Force of habit, yeah.
You should be a politician. Clara, tell me what restoration projects then have the greatest impact?
So it's a very tricky question because it depends what kind of impact you're interested in. And I think that we're all laser focused on climate change these days, which is incredibly important. It's a big existential threat that we face. But even if climate change were to go away today, we would still have challenges around the way that we manage resources, the way that we produce food, what that means for clean water and clean air. And so as we think about impact, that's the kind of question we need to ask ourselves. Is impact about maximizing CO2 emissions? Is impact about preserving biodiversity because of the benefits it has for, you know, medicinal value or pandemic prevention? Is it about bringing more water into specific soils? So we tend to try to think about all of those different impacts, and different projects will focus on different ones, but it's important that that holistic picture comes together as we figure out what to do where.
Now, Clara, you mentioned climate change, and climate change really impacts food security, for instance.
Absolutely.
How does ecosystem restoration help to address or ensure that we have food security within the communities.
Absolutely, and I'm glad that you mentioned it in the context of climate change, because actually they can be overlapping and self-reinforcing solutions. So for example, if you bring more trees into an agricultural landscape, that serves to provide income diversification for farmers, because you might have non-timber forest products, fruits, or even actually timber products, the ability to use the trees themselves for firewood or something else as part of your agricultural system. That increases food security and resilience. It also sequesters carbon. It means that the soil is more likely to keep water and retain water, and so you're more resilient to drought. So there's a lot of incredible overlapping benefits there when we think about restoration in the big sense of the word, not just reforestation projects, but all of the different ways that we can actually bring more life into the land that we use and that we manage.
These are very complex topics. And Jay, you spoke about measuring the impact, and you spoke about the impact itself, Clara. How do we increase the understanding between these two?
It's such a tricky question, because reaching different audiences requires different strategies, right? From the Restor perspective, one of the ways that we're trying to help spread the word is by bringing transparency to work that's happening. And we're focused in the nature-based solution space, so we're bringing transparency to what's happening from a land management perspective, restoration work and conservation work. We hope that inspires other people to do work. It lowers the barrier to entry, so it's easier for people to get engaged. But I think that transparency principle works for other sorts of sustainability efforts as well. I know that there's efforts now to be able to actually observe from space point source CO2 emission, right? So that you can see what's happening where. And I think that that can be a part of change when we're able to see and therefore eventually measure and therefore manage these impacts.
Oh, that's incredible. You can actually pinpoint it from space.
I know. Satellites are incredible these days.
Wow. So CO2e quantification then, which you lead here at Bühler, tell me a little bit about why that's important for innovation. Can it drive innovation?
So I think it's really about what is the direction the industry has to go? And many, many more of our customers, indeed us as a company, we're being asked to report on our environmental impact, CO2, but also other metrics that Clara mentioned, impact on land use, energy, waste, water, etc., this environmental topic. So the impact it has is that there won't be businesses in the future unless they're going in this direction of sustainability. And measuring now is really important, because there's going to be, and there already are, changes, and that means there's a huge investment. So we need to smooth that investment curve by measuring now and then looking at the decisions that have to be made. And that's where you start to see innovation coming to the market and more pull for sustainable technologies. So we're seeing more electrification of ovens in baking processes and in drying processes. We're seeing more digital technologies tracking the quality of products and the sustainability of products all the way from the field through the value chain, being pushed by what the market is asking for in terms of sustainability, which is going through the retailers and then to the processors. And that pull on sustainability is really changing the types of technology and procurement decisions, and therefore innovation to supply these right technologies.
Great, Jay, thank you so much. I mean, now you've spoken about how the journey continues, right, from measuring these impacts. Well, how do we then help people to translate the findings into really sustainable jobs and business models and businesses, so that we're not just restoring now, but also ensuring further initiatives in the future?
Yeah, that's quite a big picture question, sustainable jobs and sustainable processing. I think what Clara mentioned as well is that there's a lot to this, and food security is one topic and the big picture of sustainability. And there will be more jobs and smaller things, innovation and technology and turning ovens from gas to electric and all of these other processes. But I think it's more about making sure that the companies themselves are on the right journey. They're able to measure things like their environmental impact and everything else, and have food security and provide safe, affordable, scalable nutrition or mobility, and making sure that the companies of the future are able to exist by by really sort of hitting those trends, and then we keep people in those right jobs at the right focuses, and you're seeing more people perhaps like me, where you are looking at environmental impact within the company, driven by what's being pulled for by consumers. I think what you've got around restoration and the network that you're accessing is also pretty important in terms of jobs and local communities and things like that.
Right. Ultimately, we know that if we want to achieve the scale of restoration and conservation that's necessary for these big picture impacts of climate and biodiversity and people, it has to be a more economically viable option on the ground. And that means translating that protection and that restoration into quantifiable benefit that someone pays for. And ultimately, we should all be paying for that more, right? And we are all in some way freeloading from the way that natural resources are giving to us. And ultimately, that just has to get switched. And that gets switched because we measure it, and then we account for it, and then we actually pay for it. And someone else, you know, on the ground needs to be paid for that.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. All this data that you guys get tells you whether you're doing the right thing, whether you're doing a good job, okay? Without the data, you don't know. You're kind of just stumbling around. So data transparency must be vital. How important is it, and where are we in terms of data transparency within this field? How opaque or how clear is it?
You start first with Restor on a big picture, and I can maybe talk about some other things.
Transparency obviously means different things to different people, right? One is transparently accessing data, simply being able to take what's out there and getting into the hands of people who can actually do something with it. Transparency is also about saying, what am I doing and what is the impact, so that we can build accountability and trust into what's happening. I think, you know, those two things together are incredibly important. It's also key to say that data and data transparency, in a way, is the minimum.
Yes.
You know, it's what we do next with it that we should be focused on. But of course, it's an enabler. But I think it's always important to give ourselves a pat on the back and say, look, yeah, we're making the space more important, more transparent. We're driving forward the way that data is shared. But we're not actually having an impact until change happens on the ground. I think in your space and CO2 quantification specifically, you know, it's just a different subset of data and a different use case around the transparency.
Yeah, and I think the reason why Restor is interesting is because you guys are taking enormous data sets and really making that widely available. And I also referred to earlier a combination of primary and secondary data. And in a similar way, there are huge databases with averages of these figures. And we really rely on those, and the quality of those is improving. But from my perspective on your data question, the key thing is getting more primary data into the hands of the right people and then communicating it in the right way. We can have all the data, but if we optimize for one environmental metric and not another because we haven't communicated it, it might be a really nice subset of data, but if you haven't sort of got the whole piece of the puzzle in that right scenario for the right stakeholders, then you can have all the data in the world, but you might not make the right decisions. And that's where we're really focusing from a technology standpoint to look at the entire portfolio of Bula's technology and be able to communicate not only the environmental impacts, energy, waste, water, CO2, land, but then also impacts on the circular economy, because that's going to be a key enabler. Or the impact on the SDGs, the only globally aligned set of frameworks and goals that we have. And also looking at the bigger picture and then encouraging more customers to measure and getting more primary data so that we can then improve and communicate better the data sets.
Great, so we are measuring the impact, we're communicating the impact, and then we're empowering communities and people to drive sustainability. Thank you very much, Clara. Thank you very much, Jay. And we look forward to seeing more restoration projects. Thank you for tuning in.